graphic audio. A movie in your mind.
Graphic audio presents Guardian, a Rylee Adamson novella by Shannon Mayer. Narrated by Nora Achrati and Chris Genebach, and performed by a full cast. To say flying on the back of a dragon at high altitudes is cold is like saying Death Valley warms up a little in July. And I'd been doing it, flying by dragonback at high altitudes, for more hours straight than I cared to count.
Fucking hell.
Liam tightened his hold on me. I faced him on Blaz's harness, my legs wrapped around his waist. Being the hot-blooded shifter he was, he didn't feel the cold like I did. The proximity to him helped, it did. Just enough to keep me from turning into a popsicle. Blaz, dragon extraordinaire, laughed and sent his words to us.
Stop being such a pussy, Rylee. This is the vacation you wanted so badly.
I didn't have it in me to answer him. I settled for flipping him the bird. We'd started our mini-vacation spending time near London, at Jack's place, where the books of prophecy had been kept. I'd wanted to have another crack at them, hoping to find the key that would end the terror that was Orion and his demon hordes coming our way. For 3 days, Liam and I looked for the books, but they were gone. Now we coasted along the northern line of Russia, following the water's edge most of the way, pretty much as far north as we could be without hitting the pole. We'd come this far north, and east, to visit the wolf pack of an old wolf named Peter, so Liam could learn from them, understand his own power and what he could do with it. A sharp blast of icy wind smacked me in the face, a cold slap reminding me exactly where I was.
We're almost there, Pansy.
We began our descent, and I dared to peek out of the tiny warm spot I clung to between Liam and me. Blaz headed inland in a slow circle toward a bare patch of snow surrounded by trees and white-capped mountains. As we circled, the ocean came back into view, distant waves crashing to the frozen shoreline. 3 sides of mountains, 1 side of ocean, and not a single road that I could see. Squinting, I pointed to a splotch of brown that seemed out of place.
Liam, what is that?
He turned to look, his eyes dilating, making the silvery gold of his irises fade.
Looks like a village. Seems odd for the middle of nowhere.
No kidding. Knowing how far north we were, I hadn't expected to see anyone except the wolf pack we were to spend time with. Certainly not a human village. I cast another glance that way, but saw no movement. Of course, the dead of winter in northern Russia wasn't exactly the time to be playing in the great outdoors. Blaz landed, his back claws digging into the hard-packed ice and snow in the small clearing. The ground squeaked under his weight, that awful squeal that tells you it's too damn cold even for snow to be light and fluffy. After untangling myself from Liam and unhooking from the harness on Blaz's back, I slid down his side and landed on the snow.
I have something for you from Doran.
Now that was curious. Why didn't he give it to me himself before we left? Blaz held out his right front claw to me, his digits uncurling one by one. I glanced up at him. Do you know what it is?
He only told me not to give it to you until we landed. Something about a time limit.
Son of a bitch. I peered into Blaz's claw. A small jewelry box stared back at me. I lifted it out, my hands shaking with cold. Cracking it open. Yeah, I squealed, though I will deny now that any such noise ever came out of my mouth. A round stone, smooth and black, with a rainbow of reds, blues, and greens flickering through it. I'd worn a similar opal during my time fighting off the frigid cold of a hoarfrost demon's poison. The fire opal hung on a thick silver chain, and I quickly put it on, tucking it under my shirt so the opal came in contact with my skin. It hung against the black snowflake tattoo between my breasts, and the instant it touched me, the heat flowing through my veins reminded me of sliding into a hot tub, shivers of pure delight washing through me. I felt nearly drugged with the euphoria of being truly warm for the first time since we left Jack's place in London.
Remind me to thank him when we get back.
He'll likely want the kind of thank you only I should get from you.
A flutter of paper from the box in Blaz's claws caught my eye.
Come back soon, Tracker. We need you here in one piece. Don't make me call in favors to save you. I'll bite your delectable ass if I have to do that. Love, Doran.
Yeah, that was Doran, him and his ass biting. Liam took the paper, read it, and bunched it up into a ball before throwing it away.
Idiot.
Blaz launched himself into the air, surprising me.
Where do you think you're going?
I have things to do. I'll be back for you in a week. Call if you need me sooner.
The backdraft from his wings slid around us, swirling up the snow crystals not hardened into ice, battering them against our bare faces. And then, for the first time in what seemed like forever, Liam and I were truly and completely alone. No Alex, no Pamela, no monsters chasing us, not even Blaz to interrupt with an inappropriately placed comment. I almost didn't know how I felt about that. Liam, though, seemed to have no such reservations. He slid a hand around my waist, then down over my hip. The heat between us flared as I turned, and he pulled me toward him, slow and steady, his eyes never leaving mine.
How well does that fire opal work?
How do you mean?
His lips quirked as he bent, brushing them against the spot on my neck just below my ear.
Will it keep your naked body warm on the snow?
A shiver rippled the entire length of my body. Hot and cold, the ice below and Liam's body above. It was a heady image that curled through my mind, one I couldn't banish.
Worth a try.
His teeth nipped along my shoulder, and I realized he'd already started to peel me out of my clothes. He bent his knees and wrapped his arms underneath my ass, lifting me with ease.
I think over there might be better.
I didn't look where he was headed, just trusted him. I let my fingers trace the edge of his face, down his jaw and neck, the light stubble prickling against my skin. Tears pricked at my eyes at the love between us, the reality that I had someone who would hang on to me until the end, whether bitter or sweet. There wasn't more I could ask for in a mate. His eyes glimmered, and the emotions around us swelled. Slowly, he stripped us both of our clothes, laying them on the snowbank where the drift was softer. When I wore nothing but the opal, and Liam less than that, the real torture began. The wind was warm against my skin thanks to the fire opal, but it held nothing to the rush of heat Liam's fingers and mouth traced over my body, the ache in me heightening with each touch. He slid his hands down my thighs to the backs of my knees, down my calves to my ankles, and then slowly back up again, curling to the inside of my thighs. He worked me into a near frenzy, my knees barely able to hold me upright, and then the bastard stopped, a split second before I crumpled to the ground.
Why did you stop?
He pulled me down with him to the rough bed made out of our clothes, then reached up and spread my hair out, fanning it around my face.
So beautiful.
I reached for him, and he batted my hands playfully away.
Let me have my fun. Then you can have yours all you like.
Slow and steady, he strummed my body like a master violinist. Each sweet stroke of his mouth and fingers drew me to a higher peak that he didn't let me quite touch. Over and over again, he brought me to the sharp edge of pleasure, only to pull me back from it.
Liam.
He lifted his face, eyes pinning me to the ground.
Beg.
Oh my fucking gods.
Please.
I lifted myself to meet him, our rhythm steady, one born of stolen moments and a love so bright neither of us could contain it. The crashing peak came for us at the same time, rushed over and through our bodies in mind-numbing waves that left us spent in each other's arms. Liam slumped against me, then rolled to his side, our bodies still joined, his arms tight around me. He ran his fingers across my cheeks, then buried them in my hair. I smiled up at him and cupped his face.
Blessed are those who find love, for it shall lead them home.
Where did you read that?
I shrugged, for the first time feeling a bit embarrassed.
Just kind of came to me.
A smile tipped his lips up.
Truth comes in funny ways.
Like right after an epic fuck in the snow.
I wanted nothing more than to stay in that moment, to know nothing but this joy of his arms around me. But that was not how things worked in my world. Liam rolled to a crouch in a single motion that bared his delectable ass to me. I couldn't resist giving it a slap before I grabbed my clothes and scrambled into them.
Woman?
His eyes glittered with a heated desire that sparked my libido, and for a moment I forgot we were about to be seen buck naked. Or at least, Liam was going to be seen buck naked. That made me smile. Later, wolf. I had my clothes on and wished I had my weapons. Someone had talked me out of bringing them, arguing that I wouldn't need them. This was a vacation, and I'd have a werewolf guardian and a dragon to watch over me. See what love can do? Make you downright silly. I grinned, though I made sure I kept it from Liam. Silly. I kinda liked it. Across the clearing, a figure stumbled into the open. Her cries were loud against the wind, the pain in her words undeniable, even though I didn't speak a lick of Russian.
She's lost her child.
Liam shrugged into his coat.
How do you know?
Years of watching mothers slumped over crinkled pictures, watching their hope fade and their hearts break. Doesn't matter what language they speak.
The woman wore layers of clothes frosted with ice. Her boots were ankle high, barely peeking above the snow, and her gloves were thin. These were not the clothes to keep someone warm in the dead of winter. Here and there, I saw thick fur adding a small measure of protection.
Hello?
She was about 10 feet away now and tipped her head toward us. I went very still. Her tears had frozen against her cheeks and sealed her eyes shut. She lifted her hands toward us, stumbled, and I ran forward without thinking. This woman was no danger to us, but she was going to get herself killed if we didn't warm her up fast. Without another thought, I slipped my opal off and pressed it against her bare skin. A shiver slid through her, and then a heavy sigh as the ice on her face melted. The scars from frostburn wouldn't heal, but she could at least open her eyes and see us. She parted cracked, bleeding lips.
American?
Yes. I held her, fought not to shiver against the wind I felt again. How the fuck had she lasted this long out here?
Child. Baby. Missing. Please help.
Liam crouched beside us.
Everywhere you go, Rylee.
I ignored him and focused on the woman. Baby. Girl or boy? She fumbled inside her layers of clothes, her hands as damaged by the cold as her face, finally pulling out a crumpled black and white photo. She held it out to me and I took it carefully. The child couldn't have been more than a year or two old, but it was hard to tell. The picture was faded and wrinkled, handled and loved in the absence of the child. I felt a deep ache of sympathy for this woman. Name?
Katya.
Good enough. I sent out a thread, tracking the little girl. Nothing. Shit. Liam touched my shoulder.
What is it?
The picture isn't recent enough. I can't get a bead on the kid. Or this might not be the kid she's missing. Something doesn't match up.
Or maybe there isn't a child at all. That picture is old.
Could be an old camera.
You can't save them all, Rylee.
He wasn't being a jerk. His hand squeezed my shoulder softly.
Perhaps this is one of those you can't bring home.
My heart twisted. Carefully, I took the picture from the woman. I find her. You go home. Her face lit up, scoring me like a hot brand.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.